Well, thank you for the very generous introduction. If it were up to me, I would just introduce myself as a recovering government bureaucrat. But it's really an honor to be here, to honor George Woodruff for the impact he has made on Georgia Tech, which is, as you all, I'm sure, would agree, is one of the premier institutions and the Department of Mechanical Engineering in the world. And it's really a personal honor because when I look back at the speakers who were here before, I find I'm in the company of some real statesmen. My former advisor, Changlin Tien, was here 23 years ago. And some of my recent mentors during my time in Washington, Chuck Vest and Norm Augustine, who were also speakers in this. So it's a real honor. And it's a real pleasure to be here. I had a delightful day yesterday speaking to students, faculty, spent some time talking about research. And this was therapeutic for me in my recovery back to academia. So that was wonderful. Really enjoyed that. So thank you for inviting me. I'm going to talk about options. And the options to create a sustainable energy future. And these are technology options mostly that I'll talk about, but I'll end with some policy options and see if we could clean up some of the policy work that's going on. But when we talk about energy, you know, you have to consider this from what I call three securities. And that is the national security, economic security, and environmental security. Because these options that we are going to talk about, if they adversely affect one of these, they're just not sustainable in the long term. So they all have to address these three securities. But before I talk about these options, it's very important to understand where we are today and in the energy space and where we have come from, the history. So I'd like you to take a moment and imagine yourself during the times when the United States was being created by the forefathers of our nation. And what we have in our memory are writings, famous writings, some documents that created this nation, and some pictures, some paintings. And this is, you know, George Washington during the Revolutionary War, and Thomas Jefferson writing famous documents, and the mode of transportation were horses, and the mode of lighting was whale oil. That's what they used for lighting. And I don't think anyone, if you were to go back in history in a time machine and ask them, could they have imagined a world today like this? I think the answer would be, it's fair to say it would be no. And I think it's very difficult for us to plan 250 years from now. But we can certainly see some trend lines for the next few decades and see if we are on the right track or not. So we have come from this in the last 250 years. This was what life was like. We've come from this to where we are today in this massive scale of development and innovation, which was only last 250 years, which is a blip in the history of humanity. And here we are today. And we call this what I call horsepower to horsepower. And because we travel to the grocery store in a car with 300 horses put together in a machine which is of around this size. And I flew from California to here in about 100,000 horses in a time which is only a few hours, which would have taken a month or more 250 years ago. And this is, you know, this is an amazing development in human history. And we light ourselves with this. And I don't think people could have imagined, the first president and a few of presidents could have imagined this was life would be like. And the economic impact of that has been just spectacular. This is the global per capita GDP, not the total GDP, per capita GDP that has gone up exponentially. And along with that has been the exponential use of energy. Because without energy, there is no economic growth in the modern economy. So economic security is built in, because all about mobility, about automation, motion, it's all about energy. Because if the grid stops, if the oil starts flowing, we come to a standstill. And so these are energy and economic growth extremely well correlated. But there's another exponential growth that happened during this time, and that is population. During the early stages of the Industrial Revolution, 250 years ago, the world population was 0.7 billion, 700 million people, and today we have 7 billion, and in the next 20-30 years, it'll be 9 billion, and we'll be, by the end of the century, about 10 billion. Okay, so that's the growth, and it's, you know, we have to account for that, because at the end of the day, people use energy. And if we have more people, there'll be more energy used. And the question is, what do we do about this? The low-cost extraction of shale gas and shale oil. And that has been going on since the early 80s, when no one thought shale would be a resource. And at that time, the Department of Energy actually supported R&D to do that. And then the private sector picked it up. And in about 10 years ago, 10 years from back, they were able to reduce the cost of extraction till it became profitable. And that has changed the ball game in many ways. And if you look at the implication of that on oil, which is it's important because that's the only thing we use for transportation, and you find that if you look at where we import our oil from, most of our oil comes from Canada. And you see that Saudi Arabia and Mexico are pretty close. And what has happened in the recent past is that Mexico has changed, amended its constitution so that we can extract, private sector can go and help Mexico extract oil. And what you'll find is that the Mexican imports will go up. And what we will find then is North America as a strategic block of countries which will have access to oil in many ways, energy independence, oil independence, which is, I think, a tremendous deal in terms of national security. There are other national security issues, but this particular one is a really good news story. So I talked about the economic impact, about national security. Now let me talk about the environment. And there are lots of things going on out here. On the left-hand chart, is the temperature rise that is going up. And the best correlation it has is with the CO2 concentrations going up. And this we know is global warming. We don't understand climate change. We don't know exactly the implications of that it'll have on climate. But what we do know for sure, and there is not just this kind of data, but isotopic evidence that it's from fossil fuel, and that is going up. And that's a real issue. And if you look at the carbon dioxide emissions from the United States, that's actually going down because of efficiency in our economy, in how we use energy, and also the transition from coal to natural gas that we're going to I'll talk about. But you find that China is going up. U.S. and China has made a commitment together in last November that China will also reduce its emissions. But that's 2030 or so, before 2030. We'll see how that goes. But this is a real issue. And this is a transgenerational issue. We have to address this. And there's a technology, science, and engineering aspect to it, but there's some policy aspect as well. Just to highlight some of the things, I mean, what you see on the left-hand side is the average temperature of the world, of the Earth, that is going up. The average temperature. But as you can well imagine, that average has a distribution around it because these are statistical things. So what I'm going to show you next is the distribution. And in fact, what I'll do is to show you the distribution of land temperatures, which is what affects us, land temperatures on the northern hemisphere during summer. So some summers are hotter, some summers are colder. We can't predict where those hot summers are going to be, because we don't understand climate change. But it's important to look at the data to see where it's going. So I'll show you this thing. The first is the theory, and the horizontal axis is the deviation from that average that I talked about. And let's look at the data. So the red is hotter summer, and this is 1960s, 70s, now, starting with the 80s. And you can see where this is headed. And what you find is that we are now reaching probabilities of these extremes of temperature, which you can't predict where it's going to happen. They happen like hot spots, and it happens in one region. In 2012, it happened in the Midwest. In some other years, it happened in Moscow, where there was a heat wave, people died. So we can't predict exactly where it's going to happen, but it's reaching probabilities of going 4 to 5 times the standard deviation at probabilities that we never imagined before. And that's what's going on. And this has the tails of the distribution have a disproportionate effect on our lives because it stresses the grid, it changes agriculture, it changes the biomass around us. So this is, and changes the ecosystem, diseases are flourish in this warm weather. Cholera is known to flourish in these kinds of, in extremes of temperature. So we have a problem on our hands, and it is now implicated because of the CO2 emissions that is based on fossil fuel because of the isotopic data. So one may ask the question, if you aggregate what's happened over the last 250 years, what is the magnitude like? What are numbers? And so it's the lifetime of a CO2 molecule when you emit, if it goes in the atmosphere, is a few hundred years. So the carbon dioxide molecules that were emitted by James Watt when he was running the steam engine are still around. So it's a big capacitor. It just accumulates, aggregates, and doesn't go away, except for the oceans. So what is the total amount of CO2 that we've emitted to the atmosphere? Because it is the atmospheric CO2 that really matters in terms of global warming. And that number, so that's the question, how much CO2 have we emitted since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution? And the number is roughly about 1 trillion tons over the last 250 years, 1 trillion tons. And the next question one may ask is, given the known reserves of fossil fuels that we have, oil, gas, and coal, given the known reserves, if you burn all of that to produce, to run our economy, how much more can we emit based on known reserves? And by the way, those reserves keep increasing because the technology to extract them keeps going down. The cost goes down, so we have more and more reserves. There is no peak oil at this point. So how much more can we emit if we keep going and based on today's known reserves? And the answer is about 3 trillion tons, 3 times more. Then you ask the question, if the first 1 trillion tons of CO2 took 250 years, based on our current economic growth and our use of fossil fuel, business as usual, how long will it take to emit 250 million or 3 trillion tons of CO2? And if you do the numbers, it turns out to be 75 to 100 years. So 3 times more in about roughly 1/3 the time. And that's the question that we're really trying to address. Then the next question is a really fair one. If you ask how much of that carbon that is there in those fossil fuel reserves, how much is it worth? And that number is tens of trillions of dollars. So the question that society is often posed is that, should we keep those $10 trillion of dollars in the ground and not use it for economic growth to save the environment? Or should we burn all that fossil fuel and economic growth and ignore the environment? That's the choice that we are often hear. And that is just a false choice because it assumes extrapolation of the past as opposed to innovation and relying on the human mind to innovate and create a new way to find better solutions. And the best way to express that is what I found was this quote by the former oil minister of Saudi Arabia. the Stone Age didn't end because we ran out of stones. We just found better solutions through innovation. And that's what we are all about. And we captured this in a paper that Steve Chu and I wrote at the end of my tenure in Washington that appeared in Nature. And we actually quoted this. And we outlined what may be some better options that we may have. So we need to invent. We need science and engineering. And we know that necessity is the mother of invention. I would add that we have the mother of all necessities out here. So when we talk about innovation, it has to be put in the context of a larger ecosystem. And I'm going to explain that a little bit, because when we're talking about energy, it's not just about the technical innovation, it's important, but it's about scale. Because everyone uses energy, so it has to, we have to talk about a commodity item, so cost and scale is everything. And if a technology does not scale and come down in cost and be competitive, it doesn't matter. So I like to put this in a framework like this, where any technology, and this is what economists use, any technology would follow a learning curve, whether it's an automobile, it's a computer chip, or for that matter, a lithium-ion battery. It follows what is called a learning curve. That is, as you do more and more, you do R&D to make it better and better and cheaper and cheaper. So as it scales, the cost comes down and the performance goes up. And we have seen this in many, many technologies. In fact, all technologies follow this learning curve. And the upstream side is where your technology innovations based on science and engineering. And then when you try to scale it using manufacturing or making big plans, you need innovations as well. But it's a different type of innovation. It's a manufacturing kind of innovation to scale, to bring the cost down, increase yields, et cetera, which is where a lot of engineers work. And finally, you got to sell this. So there's a market side to it right downstream. And if you were to look at, you know, where technology innovation happens and how does it happen, what was the role of ARPA-E, et cetera, and we had to really come up with these ideas, is the following. You know, you could take today's technology, take today's lithium-ion battery and make it better and better. And that's today's learning curve. ARPA-E's role was to create entirely new learning curves, which initially may be more expensive, you need breakthroughs, et cetera, but have the shot that in the future, they'll be cheaper and better than today's technology, so that it would be disruptive in the best sense of the word. So if you had nickel metal hydride batteries before, lithium ion batteries became disruptive to nickel metal hydride batteries. So we should be inventing inside the United States the next battery that'll be disruptive to lithium ion. I'd rather have that disruption come from inside the United States than come from outside. And so, but at the early stages, you don't know which battery will actually succeed, so you gotta have a portfolio. And most of those ideas that you wanna try, these are ideas that grad students and postdocs and faculty have in their mind. They said, you know, this is a good idea, we don't know whether it's gonna work or fail, it's worth a shot. And that's what ARPA-E was created for, is to give you guys a shot. Give everyone a shot at this, and you may fail. But I don't call those are the crosses. Those are not failures, by the way. Those are opportunities to learn and go back again and try and see you could make it better. But out of that portfolio, the hope is that one of those or two of those technologies would scale and become the next thing to disrupt today's technology. That was the role of ARPA-E. So, but these things cost money. And as you go downstream, it costs more and more money. So there's a role for the government to fund this early stage high risk research with the industry by itself will be unwilling to take. That's where the government comes in to fund the research. But as you go to manufacturing and later on, it costs more money, it costs more time. And in the energy sector, it takes time to really scale. And then you need the markets, et cetera, for, you know, whether it's consumers or businesses to buy some of these commodities and the products, et cetera. So I wanted to put this in space, in context, because when we talk about technology innovations and the options, the technology options, they would either be incremental, which is great, or they could be disruptive. And we need to figure out where we are on that map. And the energy systems, there are two kinds of systems. If you break it up, you can divide the whole energy sector into two systems. One is the stationary power system, electricity, natural gas coming to your homes and buildings, or the transportation system, which is the petroleum supply chain, as well as the automobiles and trucks, et cetera. And these two systems, it really are disconnected, except for a little connection that we're now seeing with electrification of transportation. But they're largely independent. So let's, you know, if we are to decarbonize our electricity sector, or for that matter, the transportation sector, what options do we have? And again, I'm going to rely on cost and scale. So it's important to understand what is the cost of electricity generation. And I have a marker of 5 cents a kilowatt hour, because that's the cheapest that you can do today, roughly the cheapest way to produce electricity. So on the right-hand side, you have today's sources of electricity generation. You got coal, and you got natural gas combined cycle. These are combined cycle turbines that operate at 60%+ efficiency, which are really, really efficient. And the abundance of natural gas and the low cost of natural gas has really changed the ballgame. So we ask the question, how much does it cost? And you find it's roughly out here. If we unsubsidize cost, coal is about 10 to 12 cents a kilowatt hour, and natural gas is 5 to 10 cents a kilowatt hour. So because of this cost differential, we are seeing a really huge transition that is happening in the United States, going from coal to natural gas. It's an economic reality that's happening. So on the right-hand side, so this is where we are today. And these are carbon emitting. So you ask the cost that if there was a carbon capture process out here in these, in these resources, electricity generation, how much would it cost? And that cost is over here. Obviously, for coal, because of the carbon intensity, it'll be more expensive, and natural gas, it'll be a little lower. But that's the cost of carbon. We don't have that today, but that's the cost of carbon. That's what it would be. And you find that these two resources are non-intermittent. That is, these are base load generation. I'll come back to that. On the left-hand side are the non-carbon, carbon-free sources of electricity. Some of them are non-intermittent, geothermal, nuclear, and some of them are intermittent, wind and solar. And in fact, solar can not only be intermittent, can be distributed, could be on your rooftop. You're not going to put a megawatt wind turbine on your roof, but you can put a few tens of kilowatt on your roof. So they can be distributed also. And this is very important when we come to the electricity system. So ask the question, what is the cost of these other electricity carbon-free sources? And it turns out that's the range today. These are not trends over time. This is today's unsubsidized cost of electricity. And then you say that, okay, some of these have subsidies, and you know, what is the consumer pay based on the subsidy? And you can do that, and I'll come to the options for policy. And this is the subsidized cost. What you find is that geothermal is actually quite cheap, except that it's in certain areas. You cannot do that everywhere today in certain areas. On the other hand, nuclear, it's a little expensive. It's, with subsidy, it comes down. It's a little expensive, but it's a baseload generation. And if you were to think about how to decarbonize electricity sector by today's baseload generation, I can't see a scenario to address global warming and climate change without having a substantial amount of nuclear in the mix. And frankly, we have gotten away from it over the last 30 years. We didn't build a nuclear plant, and today we have two being built. One is in Georgia, and the other, I believe, is in South Carolina. So that is the first move after 30 years, after Three Mile Island, that has happened. But this is something that we need to accelerate. But on the other hand, you find that wind electricity is frankly already cheaper than coal. And you know, there's a lot of wind deployment that is going on. The question is, why aren't we doing more of wind? And that has to happen, has to deal with the grid. And you find that solar is a little more expensive today than wind. So if that's the case, then you know, and this is United States, what about the rest of the world? What about China? What about India, which is where the major population centers are? And most of those countries are still relying on coal. So we cannot ignore coal, because if we do, the global warming is a global problem. We have a problem in our hands then. And so what are the other options in coal? And I think this is very important. If you were to do IGCC, coal IGCC, with carbon capture, the cost is about 16 to 24 cents a kilowatt hour. And we have to figure out how to either do carbon capture at lower cost or to make gasification of coal at a really, really low cost. And we had a conversation yesterday of perhaps ways to do that, maybe at different technologies than what we are doing today. So what is carbon capture like? And I'm not going to go into the details of this, but essentially carbon capture is done in a way that is, you take the CO2 molecules in a mixture, you bind it to something preferentially, so it's bonded, and then you take it aside, and then you heat it, and you separate out those two molecules. So you have to have a reactor where you bind this thing with CO2, and then you have another heater where you got to heat it and separate it out, and you get concentrated CO2. What do you bind it with? That's the X out there. It could be an amine. It could be an hydroxide. CO2 is a little acidic, so you're going to need a base for it to bind. So, but the systems look about the same. The question comes out about the cost. Today's cost, using those X's, whether it's amine or hydroxide-based, is about $70 to $80 a ton of CO2 for post-combustion capture. And you got to bring it down to less than $30 a ton, because otherwise it's not business competitive. And so if you look at where we are today, that could be translated into new thermodynamics that needs to happen in kinetics. So the cost is directly related to the chemistry. So if you, on the x-axis, the heat of reaction, which is the thermodynamics, and on the y-axis is the rate constant of the reaction. And that, the rate constant, it gives you, it relates to the capital cost, because if it's low rate, you need a big unit to capture the CO2. And the heat of reaction is the operating cost, because if it binds too strongly, you need more energy to break that bond at higher temperatures. So it's very simple. And if you do that, we are not quite at the sweet spot. Because today's MEA, if you look at the existing materials, that's where we are. The hydroxide bonding, so if you have sodium hydroxide and it forms, or calcium hydroxide and it forms calcium carbonate, that's a very strong bond. It's too strong. So then you've got to heat it to high temperatures and break it apart. So we have to figure out chemistries and reaction pathways for CO2 to be in that box on the top, to high enough rate constant but low enough heat of reaction. We don't have that today. And so this is where we need to figure out how to do the chemistry in the right way. So it's chemistry and engineers together. So this is coal. We really need to figure this out, not just for us, but for the rest of the world. Then I talked about natural gas. And this is a great, good news story for the United States. We found abundant natural gas, it's low cost, and it's not surprising that the industry has recognized that, and the largest capacity additions in terms of generation capacity in 2013 was of natural gas. Next was solar. So that is what is going on. The electricity industry is going through this major transitions from coal-based electricity generation to natural gas-based electricity generation. And that is one of the fastest transition that the electricity sector has actually seen. And that's the per year capacity additions on the top. And this is now the transition. The blue is the fraction of electricity coming from coal, and the yellow is the fraction of electricity coming from natural gas. And you can see the blue reducing and the yellow increasing. And this is mostly due to economics, and now partly due to the regulatory framework that is now being put together to reduce our emissions that is being done by EPA. Now, this, I said, is a good news story. But all of these things have two sides to the coin. And I'll give you an example of why over-dependence on natural gas is not a good thing. And I'm going to show you some data from the New England area. So imagine you're in New England, and you have the polar vortex that is coming, and you need to heat your home. And so what do? You turn on the natural gas heater, and you're heating your home. And now your demand for natural gas in New England goes up. But if you don't have the infrastructure, the pipeline, which is what is the case now, to transmit the natural gas to your homes, what happens? The supply goes down. Now, demand goes up. The supply cannot keep up with the demand. Guess what happens to economics? The price goes up. So this is what happens out here. So the blue curve that you see is the natural gas price. And you can see the spot prices, the fluctuations in the price. And that is because you don't have the infrastructure to push all this natural gas into your homes, especially in cold winters. See these spikes. These are the polar vortex kind of things that is, in fact, right now going on right now. But now your overdependence of electricity generation and natural gas has an adverse effect, because if the price of natural gas goes up, the orange curve on top is the electricity price. So electricity price goes up because you're too much dependent on natural gas. So there are many impact of these things. There's a good news and there's a bad news out here. And in this case, the New England ISO operators have not figured out what's the best solution. This is a real challenge, because if I'm a consumer, if I have a home in New England, I get a double whammy, because when natural gas price goes up and my electricity price, I'm doubling both of them. And so this is a real issue for consumers today. The energy, you know, your bills are going up today. So I just want to give you both sides of the coin. The other big transitions that are happening are the following. And I mentioned that before. Wind. You see the trend lines of wind coming down over the last several years. And now it's come down to the point that it's cost competitive with wholesale natural gas electricity production, which is why you see this uptake on the green line. The uptake is exponentially increasing, which is a great news story. But you got to see that title on the top. These are centralized generation, but they're intermittent. And that's a big deal, because our grid was never built for this. The other interesting trend lines that are happening is in solar. And solar, as I said, as you saw in the snapshot that I showed before, the cost of producing electricity from solar is higher than wind. But that is coming down. And you find that the green line at the bottom is the utility, the brown line is the commercial, and the top green line is the residential electricity. And what you find is that all three are coming down, because the panels are getting cheaper and cheaper. They're mostly being manufactured in China, and they're getting cheaper and cheaper, to the point that the biggest cost today is not the panel, but the installation, is the balance of system. And that cost will come down with higher efficiency, with less bureaucracy, frankly. And that has to change as well. And we need some science and engineering to do that too. But that is coming down. Now, how low can it get? So in 2010, Steve Chu and I were in a meeting in his office, and we started brainstorming a little bit. And we said, we got to do something about this. And we imagined what later became the Sunshot Initiative in the DOE. And that is to reduce the cost of electricity to 5 cents a kilowatt hour by the end of this decade without subsidies. This is 5 cents unsubsidized cost. So we figured that since President Kennedy had the moonshot to go to the moon and return back safely within a decade, President Obama should have the sunshot, not to go to the sun, but to have cheap electricity from solar. And so are we on track today? And what you find is the projections are that the utility scale solar, unsubsidized cost, is going to get to 5 cents a kilowatt hour before the end of the decade, just like the moonshot. And the residential price is also going down, to the point that maybe a little bit after this decade, the cost of producing electricity from rooftop solar, residential, in certain areas, not every area, Arizona, for example, Nevada, may be cheaper than the retail electricity that you buy from the utilities. And that's a question a lot of people are asking: what will happen to the utilities then? And so there's a whole industrial ecosystem that may actually have to transform itself in its business models. So this is where the residential price is, and that's also coming down. Now, solar is very interesting because it's not only intermittent, it's actually distributed. And that has a severe effect on the grid. And I'll show an example of what's going on in California. So if you look at a day in California, the total load, which is about 26 to 28 gigawatts of electricity, follows a load profile like this. And the horizontal axis is time from midnight to midnight, and that's the load profile. And you can see between noon and 4 p.m., it's kind of flat. And between 4 p.m. and 6 p.m., when people go home, the load goes up because people start turning on the lights, et cetera. So this is today. The question is, how is this evolving? This is what is going on. This is what the prediction is for the load curve, that it's going to dip beyond noon to about 4 o'clock, and then it's going to rise. And this is what's going on. This is what's predicted. And this is called the duck's belly. That shape is like the duck. And the duck is getting fatter. That's what's going on. And the ramp rates between 4 and 6 are going to be about 150 to 200 megawatts a minute. This is huge. And why is this happening? The reason this is happening is because of rooftop solar, which is a negative load. And we don't know how to manage this because in the middle of the day, in the afternoon, the grid operator has excess electricity. They don't know what to do with it because you have a negative load that is already, you know, is producing electricity and is being used. And the grid operator is now trying to introduce negative pricing. That is, they will pay you to take the electricity away. Okay, that's negative pricing, because otherwise they don't know what to do with it. And so the grid has to be thought of. When you are adding things to the grid without thinking about the system, we have a real engineering problem, technical problem, that we have to solve. And so people think, and this is what, by the way, Germany did without thinking about it. They subsidized solar, and they got all solar rooftops. And the grid, they added all this capacity, and they cannot utilize it today. And if you add capacity at capital costs, and nothing pays for it with the operating, guess what happens? The utility goes out of business. And that's what was, you know, there's some real issues going on in Germany. So the other option is maybe storage, batteries. People are thinking of batteries. Batteries are expensive, but that cost is coming down. This is the cost of lithium-ion batteries, and that the purple curve on top was the prediction, and the crosses at the bottom is the actual data. And so in 2008 or so, or 2010, the cost was about $1,000 a kilowatt hour of the battery pack. This is not individual 18650 cells, but this is the battery pack. About $1,000 a kilowatt hour. Today, it's about $400 a kilowatt hour. And the prediction is, with the Gigafactory, Elon Musk says it's going to be $100 a kilowatt hour. Other people say it's $200 a kilowatt hour. Well, let's take an average, $150 a kilowatt hour. That's really cheap. That's cheaper, or about the same cost as a lead acid battery. But this has more cycles, better efficiency, etc. So this is a huge deal in terms of not only transportation, because at $100 a kilowatt hour, $150 a kilowatt hour, the cost of a car, electric car, and the range of a car are now comparable to a gasoline-based car. And this is by the end of this decade. That's what people are imagining. So there's a big transformation that is coming. But storage may be part of the solution for the grid, but I'm going to talk a little bit about the grid, the electricity grid. This is the paradigm that we live in. You have a centralized generation, you have long-distance transmission, and then you have distribution network, and then 120 volts in your home. And this has been called the greatest engineering achievement of the 20th century by the U.S. National Academy of Engineering. But if you think about it, that architecture and that paradigm has not changed for more than 100 years. That architecture goes back to Tesla and Edison. And the paradigm is the following. You have centralized baseload generation, large power plants, because you can leverage economies of scale and bring down the cost of electricity production. Then you have the transmission grid, and then you have zillions of load that it goes to. And the generation always follows the load. What does that mean? That means that if I turn on a switch out here to turn on the lights, I don't have to worry about it because some generator is ramping up out there to supply load. So it's the generator's problem. So generation always follows load. And that's why load prediction is so important. But that's the paradigm. And now we see that when you add intermittent generation, we have a problem because it's not in this paradigm. And that's the biggest challenge for renewables. It's not the cost, it's the integration onto the grid. So how does the grid operate? Very quickly, this is sort of grid 101. You have various time scale. There's a 16 millisecond time scale, which is the cycle. A 60 hertz cycle is 16 millisecond. And some things happen shorter than that, it's like faults or voltage spikes. Then you have the frequency regulation, and the other extreme is asset planning for a utility. That's a 10-year, 20-year time scale, and there's major capital cost to that as well. In between, the grid operates based on markets. There's a technology and economics have to, and markets have to play together. There's a day-ahead market, and there's something called the hour-ahead market, there's a five-minute market, and there's really short time, a few seconds, frequency regulation market. So what happens in the grid today is the following, that everything depends on load estimation. Most of the electricity that is coming here today was planned out yesterday. 95% was planned out yesterday. And that is the day-ahead estimate. And that is that estimate of the load is based on history, weather, etc. If it's a colder day, you're going to need more energy, and so they have to plan for it. And they have a market bidding process, and you know that happens the day ahead. But they don't quite get it right. They get to about 95%, but they can't get that last 5%. So what do they do? Well, you have a big knob, then you have the smaller knobs. To get it right, they trade on an hourly basis to ramp up some generation, etc. And that's the 4%, and they can't quite get it right with that. They have to get the frequency regulation market, which is about 1% of the load. And frequency is a proxy for an imbalance between load and generation. So that's how dispatch is done today. And this is the paradigm, and this is paradigm of operation of the grid is based on the base load generation. You could do that. But now the question that we have to ask is because there are lower cost option, which are wind and solar, and they're going to be much cheaper in the future, and but they're not base load. And now people are asking to predict the generation capacity of wind a day ahead. That's extremely hard. And so the grid operation does not commensurate with how the intermittent generation sources are. So one of the things, the easiest thing to do, it's not that easy actually, is to take that numbers of 95, 4, and 1 and maybe make it 70, 25, and 5. And if you could, that requires control system. That requires information and what's going on in which part and geographically distributed. And of course, the next part is, you know, so that you can now take most of the generation capacity of wind and solar and not do it on the day ahead, but in the hour ahead market. That's the idea. If you could do that, we've solved a big problem. The other part is load. We always had the paradigm that generation will follow load. Well, why can't load follow generation? Which means that there's a system that information needs to flow as to whether the generation is coming down, and if the generation is coming down, maybe the lights could dim a little bit because the sun is getting shaded. Maybe the lights could dim and balance that. And we don't have that system today because we don't have information flowing. This is what is the smart grid. The smart grid is not about just getting data. It's really balancing an operational activity using the information that is there between generation load. It's not just demand response, it's supply response. It's demand and supply working together. So that needs to happen in the United States, and it's going to take some effort, but there's a lot of engineering that is, you know, that is embedded in that. So I've been talking about the United States. Let me talk about the world a little bit. This is a global issue. This is where the people are, population, and as I said, people use energy. And if I overlay on top of that where the lights are, you get an idea of what's going on in the world. The United States is bright, and we need to make it brighter in a sustainable way. But there are many parts of the world where people have not yet turned on the lights. And we should enable them to turn on the lights in a sustainable way as well. But there's a massive mismatch of where people are and where electricity is. And so just to give you an idea, the numbers. The 3 billion people have either no or very limited access to electricity today. Out of 7 billion, 1.5 have no access to electricity, no grid. Another 1.5 billion people have very limited access. By 2050, additional 2 billion people will be added to the same regions as those that don't have electricity or very marginal access to electricity. And that'll be about half the world's population. The world's population is growing at a rate that's faster than electrification in those parts of the world. And so, for example, we're talking about solar. One of the best thing that has happened is the cost of solar coming down and storage coming down. Because the idea of solar grids with storage and load control will be a key enabler. And we don't quite have it together in terms of an engineering issue. We haven't quite, don't have the solutions. So this is, you know, this is an important aspect from the global point of view. The question we can ask is, with all this that we are doing, with renewables, hopefully nuclear, et cetera, are we on track to address climate change? And that's a fair enough question because I said that that's a transgenerational issue. So what is the rate of CO2 emissions? And I'll just give you just the overall view. The rate of emission is going up annually. That means next year we're going to emit more than this year and keeps on going. And you can do, and this is the only equation I'll show, by the way. You can do a simple mass balance. The rate of change of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is the rate of emission minus rate of absorption. I mean, it's very simple. And if you say that the only absorption that we're getting is in the ocean, and that's the majority of the absorption, it's acidifying the ocean, but let's say it comes to an equilibrium immediately. It's not the few hundred years, but let's take the best case scenario that the CO2, whatever you emit, it comes to a, you know, in Henry's law equilibrium with the ocean immediately. You can rewrite that equation and you find that the rate of emission, a rate of the change of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is proportional to the rate of emission. And so you can see that if carbon dioxide, the rate of emission is proportional to time, the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere will go as T squared. And that's exactly what's happening. It's, you know, I've not complicated equations of various aspects. This is simple. And so all the things that we're doing today in terms of decarbonizing our sources, making electrification or transportation, et cetera, is trying to reduce the emission rate from linear to hopefully flat. But even if you have it flat as an emission rate, you know the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere will go up linearly. And we have a backlog from 250 years ago of about a trillion tons of CO2. It is the problem of our generation. And it reminds me of another time about the beginning of the 20th century. In fact, the end of the 19th century, I'm going to go back to history now, of another crisis like this that we had, that humanity faced. And this goes back to Sir William Crookes, the president of the British Association for the Advancement of Science, in 1898, calling upon science to save the world from impending starvation. Because we didn't have enough nutrition in our soil to feed the people. And so, and the reason being that most of the fertilizers were coming from South America. Initially, guano islands, right off the coast, the Pacific coast of Chile. And guano in Spanish, I'm told, is bird poop. So these islands were filled with bird poop. And people used to dig those. They had a lot of nitrogen and phosphorus, et cetera. And that's what produced the fertilizers that grew food for United States, for Europe, et cetera. Okay? And people, there were ships that were going, and there were battles that were fought to get this guano. And after a while, you know, there's only so much bird poop you can get. They exhausted all the guano. And so by stroke of just luck, pure luck, right in Chile, in Atacama Desert, there were these the reserves of saltpeter. These are nitrates, sodium nitrate salts. And they were also fertilizer because of the nitrogen in it. And then the ships turned towards Chile and then started getting these. And William Crookes did the calculation saying that if, even if you do all that, within a few years, we're going to exhaust. The time is kind of similar. Our ships are going elsewhere to get energy today. And so this was the time that was going on. And William Crookes predicted that we have a real problem in our hands because we won't be able to feed our people. And so this was a calling upon science and engineering to solve the world's problem. And I'm telling this history because it's similar. So in 10 years, Fritz Haber, who was a scientist in Germany, in 1908, discovered a reaction that broke the triple bond of nitrogen under high pressure and combined with the hydrogen to form ammonia, which became the precursor for artificial fertilizers.
It's 12 o'clock.
Okay, I got that. And the catalyst, it turned out, was uranium and osmium. And this was just the science. Then Carl Bosch came around and turned that discovery into an engineering and produced, mass-produced ammonia at cost. And the cost was very important in BASF in 1913. And that's called the Haber-Bosch process. And there's a book written, there's a wonderful story about both of these scientists and engineers. And this was the birth of modern chemical engineering. And I say this because we have a similar problem that affects all of humanity today. And one may ask, what is our Haber-Bosch-like challenge of today? And I would say that it is atmospheric CO2, and at scale, the only thing we can do at scale today is to make fuel. The amount of carbon that we emit is more than all the carbon that we put in plastics and others put together. And so the only thing we can do is fuel. So the question is, can we produce fuel from carbon dioxide? And that needs energy. You have to go up in free energy. And that better be carbon-free energy, nuclear, solar, wind, et cetera, at $2 a gallon. And can we somehow scrub it out of the atmosphere? We don't know how to do this. And what we do today is to make use photosynthetic machinery like plants. It's extremely inefficient. Photosynthesis, going from a photon to a chemical bond, the efficiency is about 0.1 to 0.2%. And that's why we need all this land and water. And that's just too much. And so we did the calculations in ARPA-E as to how much would it cost if you were to find, and in fact people have found this, using a new kind of fuel that we call electrofuels, how much would it cost? And most of the cost is not because of the carbon dioxide, but of the energy. And that better be 2 cents. If you want to produce oil at $2 a gallon, your electricity has to be at 2 cents, energy has to be at 2 cents a kilowatt hour. And we're not there. So the real goal has to be about 2 cents a kilowatt hour or carbon-free electricity. It has to be just dirt cheap, because otherwise you can't affect transportation, you can't take the CO2 away. So again, I won't go into the details, but this is, seems like an impossible target and people would poo-poo it. And I would only add there were some very infamous predictions of the past, and I'll just say a few. This is Lord Kelvin in 1890 said, radio has no future. X-rays will prove to be a hoax. And heavier than air flying machines are impossible. He was opinionated, but he was wrong. And he seemed to convince Wilbur Wright, who in 1901 said, man will not fly for 50 years. And thankfully, there was Orville, who convinced Wilbur that that's not quite true. And the only thing, the best quote I know is by Arthur C. Clarke. Any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. And it's our job as scientists and engineers to do some magic right now. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.